All right, we are back, and this is still Crossfire. And this morning, we have fantastic news and stories to bring to you. And as usual, we try everything that we can to make sure that you're enlightened and you're informed. And that's what we do on Crossfire. I'm not alone here. Ishoma Againe is with me, and we'll be running the show together. Ishoma, good morning.
Good morning. How are you? I'm fine, thank you. Good morning, Nigeria, and welcome to Crossfire today.
All right, great to have you back at the, you know, very, very beautiful weekend.
Eventful weekend.
You know, very eventful. I mean, we had our inauguration, you know, our first inauguration party,
actually,
you know, that's Friday into Saturday.
A party in spirit.
Friday into Saturday. And then again, the Golden Eaglets won, you know, the finals of the, you know, of the under 17 World Championship.
Before the game, you know, started, one of my younger sisters, because she's so pro-Brazil, and I told her, look, young lady, as far as we're concerned, this is Nigeria, and you need to give your support to Nigeria. She was like, okay, I wish them good luck. I said, no, do not wish them good luck.
Just
wish them Buhari.
The best of luck, but wish them Buhari.
And I jokingly said, I wish them Buhari, and of course, you saw how it turned out.
I know, right? It was a very interesting match. I watched it from the beginning to the end. And then Nigeria won the World Scrabble Championship, too. It was a beautiful Sunday, you know, for Nigeria, for those of us who are pro-Nigerians, we completely looked away from the political tension in the country, and we focused on, you know, so many other beautiful things that is, you know, bringing smile and confidence back, you know, into the country.
And the Falcon has qualified also.
And the Falcon has qualified again, you know, for next year's World Cup. Now, we have Professor Chris Nwaokobia in the studio joining us this morning. Prof, good morning.
Good morning. My pleasure to be here.
Oh, yeah, great. Now, we have a very, very busy, Monday. As usual, it's Momentum Monday. We have many stories that we have put together, and we'll be bringing, you know, all of that your way yet in a little while. Now, you will all agree with me that we have been waiting for a final. We thought it was going to happen last week, but it didn't. But we have the news, you know, that this will be done this week. And so everybody is anticipating again to see to witness the inauguration and the launching, you know, of our ministers. Let me put it that way. Now, but we will definitely come back to that story in full. But let's quickly take this first one. President Muhammadu Buhari will inaugurate the new Federal Executive Council on Wednesday. Now, that's November 11, 2015. A statement made by the Special Advisor on Media and Publicity, Femi Adesina, released yesterday in Abuja, said before the commencement of the inaugural session of the council, the minister designate will take their oath of office in council chambers of the presidential villa. And according to him, the swearing ceremony will begin by 9 a.m., while the ministers designate are expected to be seated in the council chamber by 9:30 a.m. and can only be accompanied by only two guest. Now, meanwhile, the president will today swear in Professor Mahmoud Yakub as the chairman of the Independent National Electoral Commission and five others as National Commissioner of INEC following their confirmation by the Senate. Now, that's one of the stories that we definitely will be taking on the show today. Another very interesting story will be Buhari, the president of Nigeria, proposes 8 trillion naira budget for 2016. Now, President Muhammadu Buhari is proposing a budget of between 7 trillion and 8 trillion for 2016, as recorded in a document from the office of the Vice President Yemi Osinbajo on Friday. Now, last year's budget was about 4.4 trillion, which was put together and appropriated by the outgone administration led by Goodluck Jonathan. Nigeria is facing its worst economic crisis in years, brought about by the sharp fall in crude prices, as oil exports account for 70% of government revenue. The document proposed capital expenditure of about 2 trillion next year, and up from 1.3 trillion last year, which is, I mean, the previous year, which is this year anyway, but did not say how this budget will be funded. Now, let's take the next story on that particular list, Ishoma.
Okay, so 5,000 naira promise. Group threatens President Muhammadu Buhari with court action. Now, more angry reactions track the inability of the federal government to implement one of President Muhammadu Buhari's campaign promises, which is the payment of 5,000 naira monthly to unemployed youth. Now, it should be recalled that earlier this week, the All Progressive Congress rejected the corresponding motion to provide jobless youth with a stipend until they find employment. Now, Nigerians from all around the country took to social media to express their anger and disappointment. Now, in a fresh development, the Southeast Progressive Assembly, SEPA, has even threatened court action against President Muhammadu Buhari and the APC. Now, the group issued a statement titled, "Our intention to sue President Buhari and APC over non-payment of 5,000 naira monthly stipend to Nigerian unemployed youth," in which it insists that the new government owes Nigerians who voted for it.
All right, another very interesting story, which will be our last so that we can run, and then we bring you more story in the course of the show. Why tribunal sacked PDP governor in Taraba? Now, facts have emerged on why Governor Darius Ishaku of the People's Democratic Party, PDP, was sacked by the Taraba State Governorship Election Petition Tribunal last Saturday. Now, the PDP man was sent packing, and the court ordered the immediate swearing of Mrs. Aisha Al-Hassan of the All Progressive Congress, APC. Impeccable sources have now revealed that the governor was sent packing for failure to secure sponsorship by a registered political party in the April 11th pool, in the governorship election. Now, the sources disclose that Darius was not sponsored by the PDP or any political party as it is required by the law. Now, in his judgment on the petition filed by Aijia Alasan and our party, APC, the tribunal chairman, Musa Danladi Abubakar, ordered that the APC candidate be sworn, having scored the second largest votes in the governorship election on the ground that the purported nomination of the sacked governor by PDP breached Section 85 of the Electoral Act of 2010. Now, Prof, we have a lot of stories. You know, Momentum Monday, we bring so many stories, and then we touch them one after the other just to ensure that we start, you know, the week on a very good note. Now, Buhari to inaugurate ministers on Wednesday. What are we expecting on Wednesday? We thought it was going to be done last week. It didn't happen. The president is known for, you know, his, how will I put it, not communicating with the, with people or actually coming out to spell out this is the plan or this is how it's going to go and all of that. We always assume, let's believe that Wednesday is going to be, now that the special advisor on media and publicity, Femi Adesina, came out to say it will be done on Wednesday. Maybe last week Wednesday was a speculation, maybe this week's Wednesday is a reality.
No, that was gone beyond the confines of speculation. The truth is that we all thought that last week Wednesday would have been it, because since the senators have been screened them and confirmed them, we thought that last week Wednesday they would be sworn in. But as it were, it was within the confines of speculation. Now the presidency has confirmed that they will be sworn in at 10 a.m. on Wednesday, and that is definite. I believe that what is important now is the fact that having waited this long, the next 72 hours won't be too long a wait. I believe that what is important, like we saw over the, whilst they had the two-day retreat, they continued emphasis on passion, commitment, service, and dedication to the cause of a nation. And I do sincerely think that if they were able to aggregate at the point where Mr. President used the word, said they are coming to serve under very special circumstances, and the times are interesting, because Nigerians are gradually getting very impatient. Nigerians expect that the promises of change and the promises of democracy will be true and real. Nigerians want Mr. President and the Federal Executive Council to get down to work and then do exactly what they have promised. And I'm confident that God on the side of this country, God on the side of our people, that interestingly, Dapo, things will work. They point us to that. I remember that when it went on the media, both social media and the terrestrial media, that our president called the Golden Eaglets on the phone before the match and then told them to remember what they did whilst he was in power in 1985. Coincidentally, the first time we won the Under-17 championship was whilst Mr. President was there as a military head of state. And then, interestingly, we're winning it the fifth time. Five is a number of grace. The fifth time, whilst he is there as president. And then, interestingly again, we have broken almost all records. We're the first country to win it five times. We're the first country to have a leading goal scorer who's scored 10 goals in the match. And then, interestingly, I think that they point us to good things to come. When we were campaigning, I remember that those who were active in sports did say that the Jonathanian era brought us a Halcyon moment in sports. But in so short a time, in 6 months, Dakpo, we have won the World Scrabble competition in Nigerian. Our Falconers have qualified for the World Cup in one day, same Sunday. Our Golden Eagles broke all records, the best player, the highest goal scorer, the fifth time we won it. You know, it's something salutary. And I do sincerely believe that before us is a great moment, before us is a great period. And I hope that what we're beginning to record in terms of our sporting, the field of sports, we're going to record in terms of governance. I am confident that once the Federal Executive Council is constituted on Wednesday, the ministers, like they have promised, will hit the ground running. And we'll be able to essentially build confidence in the economy, build confidence in the stock market, and Nigeria will move again.
Okay, Prof. Well, let's take a look at the financial records of Nigeria. Mr. President has come out to say that Nigeria is broke. And we established last week on the program that no nation can achieve maximum success as it desires without financial strength and capabilities. Yeah. Now, of course, our ministers are coming to work under special circumstances, but with the dwindling oil revenue out there, and Nigeria as a nation is yet to position itself in that way and manner that we can at least make good revenue aside all. Do you think these ministers will be able to deliver on the dividends of democracy as we desire under such a short period of time with the limited resources we have?
I agreed that we have problems with the size and the depth of our pocket of our revenue. Agreed that the economy is bare-chested and perhaps comatose. Agreed that things are difficult. What gives me a greater hope is the fact that last year the budget was about 4 trillion. And then what we're looking at is about a budget that's double that amount, about 8 trillion. Yes, that means that somehow, somewhere, funds will come in. And then that means that there is a challenge to greater responsibility. That means the government wants to do quite a whole lot. And if we marry that with the reality of the now, that obviously means that funds are coming in somehow, like I said, and projects are going to be undertaken, parastatals will be funded, the economy will be fixed, and things will move. I am confident that we have all agreed that there must be diversification of our sources of income. Exactly. We cannot depend on oil alone. That monolithic dependence that has held us down will have to be broken. And we're looking at agriculture. But it doesn't take 1 year to sow and harvest maize. It doesn't take 1 year to sow and harvest cassava. You know, there's a lot of things we can do within the next 6 months. And essentially, what is important is the government must go back to the fields. I know that whilst I was young, this was about 1990, certain Russian agriculturists and archaeologists came here, and they said they've traversed the world, and that the most fertile soil to cultivate in the whole world is here. So I do sincerely think that we can go back to the fields. We can go back to our arable world and maximize it for profit.
I agree with you that we have arable, you know, land in Nigeria.
You don't need
farm.
2 years to
do that. I know, of course I know that. But if you've noticed the trend, some of our products have been blacklisted in the international market in terms of exporting. So that has made it difficult for Nigeria to export some certain commodities or food agricultural products, which obviously yield good revenue. And they've talked about a lot of things, irrespective of the fact that these are organic, they're not GMO related, but they've looked at the preservatives, some of the chemicals which have been used to preserve some of these grains. Don't you think that is another area the government should focus on? But so far, we've not heard anything, we've not seen anything that they're gearing towards to fixing that problem.
Let me say this. Most of the things that happens with agriculture and our exports is about politics. Most countries are beginning to go back to their soil to harvest and to toil, produce, and export. You know, if Cote d'Ivoire thrives sizably in the export of banana and pineapple, if countries around the West Coast export farm produce and make humongous profit, then there is that part of us that must be up and doing in terms of international trade politics, international rules, and preservatories. Once we get that fixed, once we get that sorted out, what is important, I sincerely think, is that when I was young, my father was a civil servant, they had ministries of agriculture that have farms, husbandry, poultry, and the likes.
Yeah.
I think that rather than keep civil servants redundant, rather than keep youth corps redundant, like obtains in Israel, you get them into mechanized farming. It's service to the country, and then they'll make profit, nation will make profit, the states will thrive. I do sincerely think that the time has come for us to wake up to the reality of the now, and which is that governance at all levels must take government and governance as serious business.
Okay.
Save and except that is done, we'll continue with states acting as beggars to the center and then begging for practically everything, money to pay salaries, money to run the economy, money to run the states, money to run infrastructure. But I do sincerely think that what we must do as a people and as a nation is to reinvigorate those avenues, those sources of income. And another part of it is human capital. You know, essentially about the three most boisterous economies in the world now are based on human capital. China, India, and then Singapore, if you like. You know, most of them are not even thriving on oil. Some of them have, but what they're doing is, Japan too, is exporting technology, exporting the human world, the human character, the human persona. And essentially, I do sincerely think that that's the present world. That's what the world is looking at. If you look at the ranks of the richest men in the world, most of them are either dealing with human capital, the IT technology and the like, and then some of them also are involved in, Zara is in fashion, Bill Gates is in IT, Paul Allen is in IT, Carlos Sims is in IT. I do sincerely think that the time has come for us to re-energize, because I know that about the most intelligent species on planet Earth are Nigerians. I say that with
true.
The greatest sense of humility, but that's truism. The best open heart surgeon in the world is from Ogun State. The father of modern mathematics, Gabriel Oyibo, is from the Confluence. Kogi State also. The father of the modern internet, Philip Emma Wale, is from Anambra State also. And so we've got an amalgam of excellent minds and persona.
All
and
right.
I do sincerely think that the time has come for government to tap into
to
this world
all
and,
of these resources
and make profit.
And then make it profitable for the country. All right, so on this note, we quickly go on a short break. But when we come back, we'll be talking about the 5,000 naira promise by APC, and it's becoming a very big controversy from every quarter in Nigeria. Will they pay? Will they not pay? It's become the question in the mind of Nigerians. When we come back, we'll be talking to Professor Chris Nwaokobia on this. We'll be right back.
So, did you like what you just saw? I know you did. It's very simple. If you want to see more, just subscribe to our channel right now.